not, for I bring you good news. These were the words of the angel who visited earth long ago to foretell the coming of Christ. Fear not, for with the coming of the promised Savior, there will be no reason to fear, and there will be peace among men. Jesus, the Lamb of God, the Prince of Peace, endured controversy, contempt, and violence in this world. He suffered mockery, torture, and death on our behalf so that our souls could know peace. As the promised Prince of Peace, he said that one day there would be an end to all conflict and strife, that he would come back and make the world anew. Under his rule, he would break the yoke that burdens us and shatter the rod of the oppressor. Under his rule, people would rejoice, the nations would increase their joy, and there would be no more gloom for those in distress. We have peace because we know the Prince of Peace is ruling even now. And though we are surrounded by chaos and violence and injustice, we need not fear. For unto us has come a Savior, bringing peace that is everlasting. We can rest at ease because we know our fate does not rest in the acts of man, but in the hands of Emmanuel. So let us join the angels in singing, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth goodwill toward men," as we celebrate Jesus, our Prince of Peace.
Good evening. Let's stand and sing together.
Then the angels and hosts. to all of you who are joining us online. Welcome. I love the Christmas Eve service, don't you? Isn't it great to be a part of this? Man. It's a night that we together get to bring in this season. God with us, Emmanuel. Yeah. Wow.
There's nothing better.
Nothing.
And every time we gather here for worship, we do it because we want to exalt the name of Jesus Christ. But how much better at Christmas? And tonight's going to be a little bit of a different feel, kind of like welcome to the family room.
So yeah, I love the family room feel. You know, partway through the service, we're going to have you have your kids come up to the stage. We got a little Christmas story for them around the chair. It's going to be amazing. We're going to sing some carols. We're going to hear from God's word. And we're so glad that we get to do that as a church, usher in Christmas tonight together. Welcome. Let's sing our hearts out.
Repeat the sounding joy.
to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." So that's what we're gonna do right now. Let's sing, "We'll Give You All the Glory." Come on.
We'll give you all the glory. We'll give you all. Sweet hymns of joy in grace.
Amen.
Amen. Amen, church. Well, hey, it's great to worship together. Go ahead and take a seat as we move to this next part of our service. Like Pastor John and Pastor Dave said, we want this to feel like it's a bit like a family room, just with our church family here today. And so we're going to, in this next part of the service, we're going to read through the Christmas story. You know, one of the traditions that a lot of families will do is they'll gather around the Christmas tree or gather around the family, and they'll read through the Christmas story. So kids, here in the service, we would love for you guys to feel free to just come up right up at the front of the stage. This is the area right over here that we have that. Our friend Sarah here is going to be reading that Christmas story. So kids, feel free to come on up right now. You can come out of your seats. You can walk to the front. We have a couple of stairs right here. Yep, Pastor John's right there. Pastor Dave's over here. Feel free to come on up. And parents, as the kids are coming up, you know, our children's ministry put together this story with all of the paintings and all of the artwork and everything like that. And we actually have little versions of it that you can bring home with you. So you can bring home one as you walk out. There's one for every kid, not just one for every family, but one for every kid. So as you walk out today, you can even take this home with you. And that'll be really great. And you can have your kid read through it tonight. Amazing. We have more kids than we have room for. I love it. I'll have to move out of the way.
Love it.
I love it. I love it. All right. All right, Sarah, go ahead. Take care.
All right. Hi, boys and girls. Thanks so much for coming up today. We're going to read the story called God Whispers Peace. Thousands of years ago, in a very small country, in a very small town, and in a very small house, there lived a sweet girl named Mary. But as sweet as Mary was, every day, Mary thought or did something wrong. She sinned, as all of us do. As Mary grew to be a woman, she learned and memorized the scriptures. The scriptures whispered peace to God's people. The scriptures taught her that one day the Savior would come, the one who would rescue them from sin. The Savior would bring peace. God whispered his peace to a very small country, in a very small town, and in a very small home. He whispers his peace to even a very small child, and even to a child just like you. Thousands of years ago, in a very small country, in a very small town, and in a very small house, sweet Mary grew to be a brave woman. One day, God sent an angel, his special messenger, to sweet and brave Mary. Mary was afraid, as even the bravest person would be. She was chosen to be the mother of God's son, the special baby who would never think or do anything wrong. This baby would never sin. Mary would love God's son, and one day he would pay for her sin. He would bring peace because her son was the Savior. God knew Mary was afraid, and he told the angel to whisper words to Mary that would give her peace. For nothing will be impossible with God. This was God's special peace. When something feels too much for even the bravest person, God whispers his peace. Nothing will be impossible with me. He whispered his peace to a very small country, in a very small town, and in a very small home. He whispers his peace to even a very small child, and even to a child just like you. Thousands of years ago, in a very small country, in a very small town, and a very small house, there lived an honorable man named Joseph. He was waiting to be married to Mary, sweet and brave. But Joseph was afraid of what he'd heard, as even the most honorable person would be. God knew Joseph was afraid, and so he told the angel to whisper his words of peace. Don't be afraid to love Mary. You will name the baby Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. This was God's special peace. When something felt too much for even the most honorable person, God whispered his peace. I am with you. I love you. God whispered his peace to a very small country, in a very small town, and in a very small home. He whispers his peace to even a very small child, and even to a child just like you. Thousands of years ago, in a very small country, in a very small town, in a very small stable, slept sweet Mary, still very much brave, and her honorable husband, Joseph. It was now time, the time created before the creation of the world. Before time was created, this moment was made where God himself would come to save us, to make peace. He came like a whisper in a very small country, in a very small town, in a very small stable. He came quietly. Like a whisper of peace, Jesus the Savior, the Son of God, came into this world. This is God's special peace. Because we need to be rescued, we need to be saved, God comes and whispers his peace. Nothing is impossible because I am with you, because I love you. When they needed it most, he whispered his peace to a very small country, in a very small town, and in a very small stable. He still whispers his peace to even a very small child, and even to a child just like you. Thousands of years ago, in a very small country, outside a very small town, and on a very small hill, there were shepherds. God could have sent his angel to fancy buildings and enormous palaces filled with powerful people. Instead, he chose to send his message to hardworking shepherds. Like a secret whisper, God filled the sky with beauty, singing a song for only the shepherds to hear. Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Then the night sky filled with song. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. God knew it would be daunting for the shepherds. God told his angel to begin with words of peace. Don't be afraid. This is God's special peace. When they didn't understand, he whispered his peace. Nothing is impossible with me. I am with you. I love you. Don't be afraid. The only way to this special peace is through my son, Jesus. He whispered his peace to a very small country, in a very small town, on a very small hill. Today, he still whispers his peace to even a very small child, and even to a child just like you. Well, boys and girls, thank you so much for coming up today. And church family, while the kids make their way back to their parents, please greet someone that you don't recognize, and we'll continue in a moment.
How you doing? Good to see you. Merry Christmas. Sorry, I couldn't fight against the sea of children coming down there, and then I came across a dude in what looked like a tuxedo. Best looking dude in the room. Let's give him a hand. Well done, buddy. Love it. It was awesome. It was awesome. For those of you who are new here or have never seen me before, my name is Jeff Bucknam. I am the lead teaching pastor here. I've been here about 6 months, and it's been really cool. Stop clapping. You guys are like, yeah. And it is really my pleasure to spend some time with you. We're going to just look at a very short passage of scripture. Almost everybody in the room has heard it. I know you've heard it because you've all watched, you've probably all watched Linus do it in the Charlie Brown story. Charlie Brown's one of the ones that my family and I, we watch every year, try to the Charlie Brown Christmas. In fact, rode my bike by a park today near Palatine that's called Charles E. Brown Park. And I was like, Charlie Brown, this is amazing. Nobody was playing football in the park, though. Not today. You probably have other movies or other shows that you watch during this time of the year. Christmas Vacation is one of the ones that I watch every year. In fact, this year I just turned it on before my family watched it, and I just was in our room laughing and laughing and laughing. For those of you who don't know Christmas Vacation, why? You should know Christmas Vacation. So if I'm going to ruin it for you, it's been out for like 40 years, so not too soon. It's a story about a guy named Clark Griswold. He's the father of a family of four, and he is in love with Christmas. Clark Griswold does everything big, especially Christmas. He wants to have a good old-fashioned family Christmas, and he brings the family's going to come, the extended family's going to come over. It's going to be huge, and you know the movie starts basically with him going out into the countryside and looking for a tree. They march through deep snow up to their waist and eventually find this tree. His daughter is frozen to death, basically. She can't see any of it. And his son says to him, "Dad, that tree is so big it won't fit in our yard." And he says, "It's not going in our yard, Russ. It's going in our living room." And sure enough, they get it. They forgot the saw. They have to dig it up, and they put it on top of their car, and they take it home. Enormous tree. They have to trim it. It breaks all the windows when you open it up. Later on, they decide, well, Clark's never done anything with the lights on the house, and so he decides he's going to do the lights on the house. And he figures out that, look, if everybody else is doing it a certain amount, then he's going to do it even more. He has some trouble getting it going, but eventually when he gets the lights going, they have to pull nuclear power to power his house because it's drained everything else in Chicago. It's a great movie. You know that, right? Some of you are like, I'm going home and watching that. You know, it's a satire, and the satire is, it's making fun of something, and what it's making fun of is us. It's making fun of the way that we do Christmas. We do it huge. You know, everybody can relate to Clark Griswold because they have at some point in their life been traipsing around the countryside looking for a tree that their father forced them to come out there. They're freezing half to death, or dad fell off the roof or something when he was doing the lights. We all know the story and how the good old-fashioned family Christmas is supposed to go. And the funny part about it is the whole movie is about how it doesn't go the way they planned. Right. Never goes the way we planned. The Christmas dinner never is the way we plan it. We all have an Uncle Eddie, and he shows up, and we all think he's a little weird, right? It's an RV, Clark. But we do have Christmas is a big deal, right? So I pulled some pictures. You know, like when it comes to the lights, you guys have been around and seen the people who do like the musical lights, yeah? Right? Some of you are those people. Can I just give? We have some counseling rooms in the back if you need to. But you know, here's one. This is a great one. This guy's got a guitar here and he's got a drum set here. If you watch these, the lights are going everywhere and it goes to some sort of rock and roll jam. The trees in Chicago, went with some friends this last little while. John Smith, who's the campus pastor here. We went with him around Chicago in the last few days looking for trees, and we took selfies in front of the different trees. This is in front of Trump Tower, forgive us. And they have an enormous, enormous tree. We had four or five of these pictures. In fact, there was one at one hotel that was white orbs, hollow orbs, and we didn't get a picture in front of that because shame on them, right? This is a tree. That's what a tree looks like, right there. And it was fantastic. We had a great time. You won't be surprised that it's not just people in North America or other places that make a big deal out of Christmas. This is a picture of actually where Jesus was supposedly born. What's interesting about it is that they've lined it all. This is all marble. They've lined it all with marble, and here are these gold urns and silver urns and some more gold urns. They felt like they needed to make it look amazing, right? Because, guys, Jesus was born there. And regardless of whether you think Jesus was God or just a really important guy, he probably most important guy in the history of the planet, likely. So they felt like they had to put it in a way that it looked great. The problem is, guys, when you read the Bible and you read the version of Jesus' birth, the only one that we basically have in any of the Gospels, it does not look like the overboard Christmas that we imagine. In our day, it looks really, really simple. I want to show you that. Christmas is a go big or go home holiday. In fact, it's really overboard, but not in the Bible. So here's the passage. In those days, Luke 2, verse 1. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus. And Caesar Augustus was a guy who had every right to make a decree. He was the biggest, baddest dude anywhere. In fact, Caesar Augustus, ruler of the Roman Empire at the time, he was the one who issued in what's called the Pax Romana, the Peace of Rome. And Rome was the whole world, right? You can even see that language here, that all the world should be registered. Yeah, because anywhere that was worth talking about was in the Roman Empire. And Caesar Augustus oversaw it all. And he brought a kind of peace. It was peace under a heavy hand, right? But he brought a kind of peace to the entire empire. In fact, people used to say about him, he was the one who brought peace on earth. Caesar himself called himself a god. People believed him to be their savior. You can find inscriptions where Caesar Augustus is described that way. So Luke starts this off by saying, hey, look, Caesar Augustus was the biggest, baddest cat around. He lived in the city of Rome, which was the biggest, baddest place around. If you wanted to do anything important, you did it in Rome. And he made this decree that all the world should be registered, and this was the first registration when Quirinius, you don't need to know a whole lot about him. He was just a subservient to Caesar Augustus for the area of Syria, but also a really important guy. Like, Quirinius was in the newspapers. If Quirinius did something, you wrote about it. If Augustus did something, you wrote about it. Do you know who you didn't write about? These guys. Everybody has to go to their own town to be registered, you know, their ancestral home. The reason they have to be registered is because they're trying to tax everyone. They got to figure out how many people they've got so they can figure out how much tax money they have, so they can figure out how many buildings they can build. The Romans oppressed the Jews. The Jews, this whole fact that they were doing this decree was a reminder to the Jewish people that they were under the hand of a foreign power. It's not something that they really wanted to do. It reminded them of all the bad things that were going on in their lives. And so here's a particular, we zoom out from these grand people in Rome and we zoom in now to Joseph. And he went up from Galilee. Galilee from the town of Nazareth. Nobody giggled in the room. And that you probably because you weren't from those times. You should have giggled. Here's why. Galilee was the place where everyone talked funny. In fact, there's a portion of scripture where it says one of the early disciples of Jesus ends up saying, can anything good come from Nazareth? Can anything good come from, I don't know, fill in your least favorite town that you drive through and think, man, I'm glad I don't live there. I lived in Canada for 15 years, and the jokes in Canada are always made about the Newfies, people from Newfoundland, which is on the far eastern coast of Canada. And the Newfies talk funny, right? If they want to say a car, the car in Perk, you're in my heart, right? So people giggle whenever a Newfie talks to them, and they're like, I don't even understand what you're saying. Where are you from, Newfoundland? So what this is, though, is this little tiny, basically he's saying, okay, we're talking about the Prime Minister of Canada or President of the United States, and let's zoom now in, right? Caesar Augustus, Biden, Trudeau, whatever. They zoom down into the Newfie, Joseph, right? He got a really good heart. Probably a fisherman out there in the sea, trusty old guy. And when he talks, you don't understand a word he's saying. These are not the important people. In fact, I don't even know if you could pick anyone less important. He's from the town of Nazareth, and he went up from Nazareth to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem. This is a 90-mile journey. Big deal, right? You just get in your car and drive. In a car, they had donkeys, I guess. You could go there. It was a real hilly way. Lots of bandits, lots of other people who would come along and try to steal from you. Usually had to go in a caravan of sorts. People who were really healthy could not make this trip. Can you imagine if you were pregnant? He was the house and lineage of David, and he was to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was, She was with child. My wife used to, when she was, 8, 9 months pregnant, she couldn't make it across the room. Right? She'd make it a few steps, and she's like, I'm tired. Honey, let's go for a short walk. And then we'd walk 6 steps, and she'd be like, okay, that's enough. 90 miles this girl walked at the hand of a ruler who they didn't really like. She's his betrothed. You see that line? So that's a word that means engaged, but it's a little different engagement than what kind of engagement we do. You know, you get engaged, you sit one knee, and oh, it's always in an airport or whatever. And so you get engaged, and here we don't have a whole lot of rules around engagement, but in the Jewish community, engagement was basically like practice marriage. You had to act in your engagement like you were going to be married, sans or without any physical touching. You weren't supposed to be together in any way. So here's a woman who's betrothed to Joseph, but she's with child. Uh-oh. Mary would have been basically an outcast in her society. She had broken some of the cardinal rules. She was betrothed, and she ended up being with child, and everyone knew that something happened in order for her to get with child. She's an outcast. Probably about 15 years old. That's when people got betrothed those days. Joseph, maybe 16. Teenagers. 90 miles. Pregnant. Newfies. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and she wrapped him in swaddling cloths. We kind of do these today. You get those blankets, you put your kid in there, and you wrap them so they can't move. Right? I guess it's pretending they're back in the womb or something like that. I used to do this and put my children on the side and then shake them like this and go shh in their ear. It worked like a charm. So I'll be in the back later for those of you having trouble. I'm going to let you know how you can get your kid to sleep. There it is, right? You wrapped him in swaddling cloths and she laid him in a manger. It's a feed trough. It's an animal feed trough. What in the world? Why do they have him in an animal feed trough? Because there was no place for them. There was no place for them in the inn. This word actually means upper room. So please don't think Holiday Inn here. Please don't think a motel. Usually what happens in towns like Bethlehem, nobody wants to go to them anyway. It's not an important enough town. It's not big. So usually you have family members there, or you have a cousin or somebody, friend of family, and you'd show up and they'd say, hey, we have room for you. And they'd put you in a place. Hospitality was a huge deal. Huge deal in the Roman world. And so if you were to turn away somebody to come and ask for your hospitality, you'd be, that's like a morally reprobate. That's a horrible thing for you to do. So these guys come along and they show up, and the people didn't have room because they had so many other people for the census coming back to the town. And so they said to Mary and Joseph, well, I mean, we've got a garage, and that's probably what this is. Here's a picture of the way they did houses in those days. You can see that the upper level is where they slept and hung out and did their cooking. But, you know, it get cold at night sometimes, and thieves would come around, and they'd want to steal the animals. And so they brought the animals inside, and they put them in. I mean, seriously, guys, if you change this donkey into a Maserati, that's a garage, right? That's a garage. So they're sleeping in the garage. There might be other people there. Who knows? It's not a crazy idea. They've got a spot. There's the manger's probably built into the side of the thing. It's a lot of times hewn out of stone or in a cave or something like that. Do you know what's crazy about this whole thing, though? Okay, let's just step back from the passage itself. Doesn't it drip with humility? I mean, this is not the way you describe the birth of the most important person in the world. This is not the way you describe the Savior of the world. Luke has put Augustus Caesar and he's put Joseph and Mary next to each other to basically say, look, guys, this is not Caesar's family. These are not the with it folks. These are the ones who nobody pays attention to in the small little town, who've been thrust out into an arduous journey, climbing over mountain and hill to get to a little town they don't want to be in, and now they're having their baby born in a barn. The 15-year-old, the 16-year-old. They're nobodies from nowhere. You don't write about people like this. And yet you know their names. Even the way it's written is humble. Have you guys noticed that before? Like, don't we want to add stuff to the story? We want an innkeeper, don't we? But there's always an innkeeper. He's always a jerk. And all the plays, you get out of here. There's no innkeeper. The way it's written is just pale. We want to create more characters. We want to have more to do it. We expect different, right? There's this old Godzilla. I always have to, any talk that has Godzilla in it is a good one, right? So here's Godzilla. You probably can't see that very well, but this is from the 2014 Godzilla movie, which nobody saw because it was horrible. But in the top here, it says, here's the tagline, a king's arrival is never silent. Right. When a king arrives, you Lion King it, right? Little guy out there. He's the heir. He's the prince. He's the whatever. That's what you do. So here's the question you need to ask when you read a passage like Luke 2, 1 to 7. You have to ask in your mind, why in the world is God, the birth of God, described so sparsely? Every other writing in anywhere in the world is written with flowery language and fireworks and magnificent prose, and yet this one is just, he's born in a barn to a teenager. Nobody's. So here's the answer to that question. Why such a humble entrance? And here it is, okay? If you don't take anything else away from what I've said so far, this is it, right? The birth of Jesus shows what God values and what's required to enter his kingdom. The birth of Jesus shows what God values and what's required to enter his kingdom. There's a story that Jesus tells a little bit later in his ministry, and it's about this Pharisee, a religious leader who walks forward to the temple where God dwells, and they're going to worship God, right, by making their sacrifices. There's a Pharisee who walks up, and kind of behind him in a little distance is a tax collector, a guy who works for the Roman Empire and is kind of, you know, he's a social outcast too, somebody that you wouldn't really spend time with because he's rich, but he got that way by bleeding all his friends dry. So the Pharisee, this religious leader, walks to the temple right up to the middle of it and says, oh, God, thank you so much that you made me like I am. Thank you, God, that you've made me somebody who's really good, who's not a bad person like all these other folks, especially not like this guy back here. Like, I do all the little stuff on the law. I tithe my 10%. I do all this. But this guy back here, he is such trash. Thank you that you did not make me like him. The tax collector, he says, he stands at a distance and he pounds his chest and he says, have mercy on me, a sinner. Don't even look up to heaven. Have mercy on me, a sinner. And the story is basically making the point that God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. It's all over the Bible. It's one commentator, a guy who wrote a great book called The Ragamuffin Gospel. His name's Brennan Manning. Here's what he said. The kingdom of God belongs to people who aren't trying to look good or impress anybody, even themselves. They're not plotting how they can call attention to themselves, worrying about how their actions will be interpreted, or wondering if they'll get gold stars for their behavior. See, a child doesn't have to struggle to get himself in a good position for having a relationship with God. He doesn't have to craft ingenious ways of explaining his position to Jesus. He doesn't have to create a pretty face for himself. He doesn't have to achieve any state of spiritual feeling or intellectual understanding. All he has to do is happily accept the cookies, the gift of the kingdom. So here's the way it works. God has done what's necessary to forgive us our sins and give us his kingdom, but the only ones who receive it are the ones who know they need it. God has done what's necessary to forgive us our sins and to give us his kingdom, but the only ones who will receive that are the ones who know that they need it. God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. So let me ask you a really important question on Christmas Eve. Which are you? Proud or humble? You proud? You got it all together? The right house, got the right face, got the right everything, got everything. You sorted it basically out. You feel very much like when you stand before God one day, you'll stand there, look him in the eye, and say, man, I did all the stuff right. I sorted it all out. Not like other people. Not like the wicked, not like the ones who didn't show up to church, not like the ones who did all this, whatever. I was a good person. So judge me, God, based upon my goodness. It's proud. You're proud. Or are you humble? Are you somebody who says, listen, the only thing that I've got, the only thing I've got is my weakness. I don't know how to make it all work. I don't know how I'm supposed to sort it all out. I don't know what the next step is. I don't know. But I do know that I need a Savior. The King of Kings humbled himself to save the humble. And that is what Christmas is all about. Charlie Brown.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plain. In the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous. He's there. whose birth the angels sing. Come adore on bended knee, Christ the Lord, the newborn King. Gloria, Gloria in excelsis Deo, in excelsis Deo. Gloria,
celebrate that together tonight, the anticipation of Jesus' birth. And I would love to invite you back to one of our Christmas services tomorrow at 5 or on Sunday at 10. And enjoy your Christmas morning tomorrow. Merry Christmas. You are loved.